Good morning, everyone, and welcome. This is Twist Gaming, where you get to play board games with us. We're coming to you live here from Dice Tower Con 2018, bringing you all the awesome board game coverage all weekend long. But first off, who are we? I'm Matt. We're Twist Gaming, and we're joined here with Stephen
Bonacore. Stephen Bonacore, Stronghold Games. Oh, hi.
It's like an echo in here.
Real one.
We got the real one.
Not the cardboard cutout, which is on BGG at sea, week two. Where Alan Moon tried to defile it, I heard, but it was removed. It stayed away. So, but it's great being here with you guys. I love it. This is awesome. In the most purple area I've ever seen in my life.
We try.
This is out of control. You now officially own purple.
Yeah.
Yes. No. There's no company in gaming certainly that can own purple. Like I've tried to own red, but you know AEG's got red, and even Vassal uses red. But no, you guys own purple.
We tried to corner the market. Yeah.
you know. I've noticed you have a few shades though too. So we
didn't want to just be one Pantone color. Yeah. We gotta get the whole spectrum.
The whole spectrum
involved.
Of everything purple. Awesome. In purple energy drinks, everything.
Oh yeah, we got cookies too. Purple cookies.
I saw the purple cookies, which I can't have since I'm on a diet. Thank you very much. Thank you for the temptation.
Would you like me to tell you just how good the fluff is?
No.
In the
Stop. You're so mean to me. Hey, we probably should talk about some games because I don't know that they—I don't know—they really want to hear about dieting and things.
You brought a very small stack. Of
just
one or two, right?
Yeah, just a couple of things. So
we're gonna be flying fast and furious.
Yeah, we're gonna fly fast and furious. There's a lot of stuff going on at Stronghold, and as it comes in, we'll just keep talking. And I'm showing so many games because literally we have something street dating, you know, hitting retail like every 2 weeks throughout the spring and the summer. So we're gonna kind of just talk about them, and the reason why do we do so many games is because we want to be the game company that everybody looks toward to say, well, what's Stronghold doing in heavy euros? What's Stronghold doing in party kind of games? So I wanted everyone to be able to look at Stronghold. Not every game's every person,
right.
Obviously, but I have something for every person.
We have an incredibly diverse library.
Very, very diverse. And this one, which just came out, called Steamrollers. Oh, I don't know which way we should do it. That way or this way or that way or...
And any way you want.
Any way you want it.
That's
oh my God! Did we just have a journey moment?
We did.
There we go. So in Steamrollers, this is like Age of Steam meets a modern roll and write game. So Age of Steam or Steam, where it's that big 3-hour kind of game, and it's an economic death spiral. But you do all these really cool things. You pick up and deliver. You upgrade your trains. You go on contracts, you draw your train lines, you do all that cool, fun stuff without the economic death spiral in 3-hour game, and you do this in 30 to 45 minutes.
Oh, so
modern roll and write game where you're picking up and delivering from the center board, and everyone's got their piece of paper that they're drawing their train lines on and manipulating the cubes that were in the center. So this is Steamrollers. It just hit the street on May 30th, and it's been flying off the shelves right now.
Which kind of gamer are we targeting with this game? Who's going to
love it? Roll and Write is like the biggest like mechanic going on right now. So if you love Roll and Writes, if you love train games, that's kind of where this sits. It's a nice medium, light medium weight game too. So anybody could really get into this game.
Okay.
And what's the price point that we're talking
this
about?
This is $49.95.
$49.95. I like that we're
right.
Testing Steven with his extensive catalog. He's got dates, prices.
I try. Oh, you picked a good one here. Yeah. All right. So first of all, this is Gold Fever. Hashtag Tom Vassal doesn't like fun. So Tom panned this. I know, you love that. So Tom panned this game. He panned it. And I'm like, immediately, I went on his show.
Wait, was that a pun right there? He was panning the gold.
Oh, very good. No, it wasn't, but yeah, he's good. So literally, yeah, he did a negative review. I didn't even know I was doing it. I picked up the license like right after that. And it's a push-your-luck game. It's a simple push-your-luck party kind of game. I call it a bar game because you can play this anywhere, at a bar, a restaurant, on the floor, waiting online someplace. What's in this is, if you can go to the top again, we can just show the little bit of the back components there. Is it this way is better?
There you go.
Sort of, I guess. So it's a bunch of nuggets, these really chunky acrylic crystals, gold, and three different kinds of gravel, black, gray, and white, and an emerald, and a ruby. The object of the game is to blind draw out of a bag, and the first person that is going to pull out all of the gold is going to win. as you draw stuff out, you can stop your turn at any time. So if you pull a gold and a piece of gravel, the gravel isn't crappy, you can bank your gold, and then you pass the gravel on to somebody else. So you're seeding the bad stuff into other people's bags. If you pull two of the same kind of gravel out, your turn's over, everything has to go back into your bag. It's simple, push your luck. There's a real-time element in it, where all of a sudden if the ruby comes out, it's a speed round, so you got to constantly watch to see what comes out. A speed round starts, everyone's pulling gold out, really trying to pull out gold really fast. Party game, fast fun, bar game, I call it. Tom didn't like it. He goes, oh, there's a first player advantage. Some first player might pull out five gold. I like to see anybody pull out the five of the 20 pieces that that are in your bag. It's like impossible to have happen, but Tom doesn't like it. Hashtag Tom Vassell doesn't like fun, but you do like fun. So you will like, back to the other one, you will like Gold Fever.
It's hard to keep up with you, Steve.
I know.
You gotta move, Matt. I like you gotta move with the buttons.
All right. This is a big release. Let's
Let's go
this way first. Okay. Maybe. There's a lot of glare on there. So this is Kitchen Rush. All right. And now we go the other way. So now it's a big close-up of the box first. So Kitchen Rush, I call this, some people call it Overcooked, the board game, that electronic game called Overcooked, okay. Which I don't play. But I like the Chef Ramsay shows. So this is like Hell's Kitchen, the board game, without a world-famous chef
Sold.
Yelling at you.
I want it.
I mean, it's,
wait,
you know.
Can I get someone to yell at me while I'm doing
it? If you would like, and we'll scream at you the entire time while you're playing the game. So this is a fully cooperative game where you are running a restaurant, okay? Mm-hmm. You're all trying to, in real time, run a restaurant, and you're going to win or lose together if your restaurant makes money, you're going to win the game. On the board, there are all of these sand timers. Each player gets two sand timers in their color, two yellows, two reds, whatever the case may be. Yep. There's actually even two extra ones that are extra help that you can bring in, but you got to pay them. So if you're going to bring the extra help into the kitchen, you're going to have to pay them. You go and you have to go and go get the orders, like a waiter. You have to get orders from the diners. You have to go to the pantry to pull out all of the different meats and bread and cheeses, go get spices, clean dishes if you need to clean dishes down over here.
This is a full spectrum. It's not just you're cooking the food, you're running the restaurant.
Look, I'll be Mary Berry, you be Paul Hollywood, and we will do this thing.
I am dressed the part.
This is a hard cooperative game. It's not going to be something that, like, you're going to play it as, you know, casual. The rules are pretty simple. It's not like it's a hard game to learn how to play it.
Right.
But it, if you want to really do this well, and we had a couple of teams at the booth. We've been playing this at the booth a lot. It's been the most popular game being played at the booth. They went and they just embraced it, and they cooperated so well. So if you like that style of game, fully cooperative and in real time, with the, you get breaks between the different rounds, but fully cooperative game in real time, you're gonna like Kitchen Rush. I keep looking at the wrong camera. I keep looking at the camera.
I did notice quickly on the back there that it's 1 to 4 players. So there's a solo player variant.
Solo player mode, because most cooperative games you can play solo anyway, but this one is one of those two. So it's, 1 to 4 players. Kitchen Rush. This street dates on July 11th. That's next Wednesday. And it's $69.95. Gorgeous custom bits in that game. Now, we talked about this, so we're just going to quickly go through this again. We did this. Let's do
Matt
this way first.
Matt didn't get to see it, but you have Fist of Dragonstones, a Tavern Edition, coming out.
We do. And this is the big Gen Con release for us, the big box Gen Con release. We'll talk about other things happening at Gen Con. So Fist of Dragonstones is a re-release of a game that came out by Days of Wonder, small company that got obviously became a very big company once they hit with us Ticket to Ride and Small World and was bought by Asmodee. One of their earliest games was Fist of Dragonstones. They, you know, lost the license, or they did not decide to reprint it. We went back out to Bruno Faiduti and Michael Schacht, great designers out in Europe, and we got the license again. We did some more development with them. We tripled the number of cards that are in the game, so now the game has this amazing amount of replayability. We tweaked the theme. It was always an auction game. It's a closed fist bidding game where you're bidding various pieces of gold to try to win the favors of characters in the game and therefore collect dragon stones, and that's your winning condition, collecting dragon stones that turn into victory points. We themed it into our Dragon and Flagon universe, so the little themey thing that we have in the beginning there says that this is being played at the Dragon and Flagon. So we kind of a little cross-marketing between the two games. And
I guess we can quickly show that. I should have done that already. That's upside down, of course, because I'm dumb. So lots and lots of bits in the game, lots and lots of wood pieces and these cool glass beads of dragon stones and all of these cards. Also new mechanic for those who do know the game, the original one. The King's Favor is a brand new mechanic which helps speed the game up. The game used to run a little bit long depending on the style of play and the cards that came out. Now this game plays easily in 30 to 45 minutes. We have 45 minutes on the box.
If this is a game that you're interested in, please make sure that you check out the Origins segment that we did where we got to we unboxed the game. Everything was all out.
Right.
We got to really get.
We almost played
the
around the two, right? Yeah. We actually were doing some bidding and everything like that. So
really, just, and one of my favorite things, just quickly about the box, and the artwork.
Ah, yeah, it's kind of cool.
It is super cool. Is the Stronghold games?
That's right.
How great is that?
And
a little special guest.
Oh, that's Percy, the cat Percy. That's my cat Percy. So if you notice, there's also a spot varnish. It's a really beautiful looking box. The background is a matte finish, and then the spot varnish on the characters really pops it and the logo.
Gives a lot of
depth
to the
gives depth to the entire thing. This is my big box release at Gen Con because we're having a launch party on Thursday night for this. It's a ticketed event. You can get a ticket. If you guys want to come and be my VIP guest, you can go.
Your launch parties are always
a lot of fun. They're fun. People come cosplay. Last year at the Flamme Rouge launch party, there was a certain nut in biker spandex that came riding in on a bicycle. Yes, I was 15 pounds heavier. I looked like a stuffed sausage. but we have a lot of fun at the launch parties. Sometimes people get to take games home with them, and everyone gets a special gift. So
where can people find out about the event for Gen Con?
Go to GenCon.com and look for Fist of Dragonstone's launch party. They can get a ticket there. I don't know if we're sold out yet, but.
Okay.
Let's read get it. Okay?
Sounds
good.
Awesome.
Room for some VIPs, right?
Always room for some VIPs at my two special tables. Oh. So the next game we have is Whoosh Bounty Hunters. Whoosh did it. No, I think that's Whoop anyway. Yeah, I know, right? I am so uncool.
This is so good.
So quick look at the cute little monster in the box, little jackalope there in the box.
Cute.
He's adorable. Well, she's adorable, right? And basically, of all these cute little monsters that are in the box. And what's happening in this game is these cute monsters are entering your town. And, well, there's no room in your town for monsters. You have to get rid of them, even though they're adorable. You've got to get rid of them. So there are three stacks of these oversized monster cards. I'm sorry, we don't have the open copy. These oversized monster cards that come out. And each one of the cards is worth a certain number of gold for victory points. And they each have symbols on the card to show how to defeat them. So there'll be like some swords, some ranged weapons, some lightning bolts, things like that. And each player will turn over a card and they'll have one of those symbols on there. When the correct symbols are shown on the table, on all the cards on the table, you can smack the monster. You have defeated him and escorted him out. We're not killing monsters. They're too cute to kill.
Bad.
We've escorted them out. And that's your victory points at the end. If you do it and you didn't wrong, you would turn it upside down and be a minus point at the end of the game. So you're defeating these little monsters with quick reaction. It's a quick reaction game.
Okay.
2 to 8 players.
Oh,
so it goes through the whole spectrum there.
Yeah, that's a big player count right there.
Big player count.
And I saw that the age range starts at 8 and up, so I can definitely see this being like a really fun game for a group of kids. I mean, I'm sure
it scales,
but...
Scales really well to adults for a light party game, but also for kids as well, sure.
So 10-minute game, nice filler game in there as well.
10-minute filler game for you. 1995. See, I had to make sure I got that right.
That was good. That was impressive.
And that just came out. Currently available. Just came out.
Okay.
Ah, nimble. This is not even my box right here because we didn't bring. It had just gotten to the warehouse before we got to. Oh, let's bring it up over here. So this is similar to the box art. We've actually expanded it. We don't have this. That's a sticker on there. So it's called Nimble. Nimble is lightly themed. As you can see, all of these, a public domain IPs, like you have Pinocchio, War of the Worlds, Alice in Wonderland. Very lightly themed. It's a card shedding game where you are going to match the target on the cards, the round circle in the middle, to the background on the card. Actually, vice versa, I believe. The background hits the target. So, for instance, if this card was on the table already, you can play the orange background card onto the orange target card to get rid of your cards. You have your deck of cards in your hand. This one I can actually show you because it's open. Look.
Yay!
Quickly.
Woo.
Quickly. Do, do, do.
I like purple cards.
Four. Yeah, it's purple cards right there. I did that on purpose, obviously. Did that on purpose. So everyone would get a deck of cards, and there would be a bunch of cards in the center to start like this, and then you would tap the card to the center to make a virtual like discard pile here, and then if it matches something in the center, you could play it there. That one didn't. Did this? I'm trying to hit the target. That one matches. That one doesn't match. Etc. Things like that.
Okay.
So I'm trying to get rid of all the cards. My first person to get rid of all the cards. Now, once you go through and you have your discard pile, you can just simply pick it up, or you can play off the top of your discard pile. So go back and forth, four people trying to get rid of their cards first. It's a 5-minute game. When you get good at this, the cards are flying like all over the table like crazy.
Exactly.
I've seen people, like expert players, play this in like a minute and a half.
Oh,
it's like it's an amazingly fun, fast game. First time we played, like, what do I do? It's really bad when you have a hangover. Yesterday morning, I was trying to play this game on to people at the table. I'm like, oh, this is hard.
There's so much
going
on.
It's so hard. So this is Nimble, and this street date's on July 25th. We will have it at Gen Con. So that's the week before Gen Con.
It's the day after my, more importantly, it's the day after my birthday.
Day after the birthday,
and
that is.
What, 22 am?
Yes. Oh, Matt, I'm so happy you remembered.
I would have thought that's about right, but okay, if it's not.
No, that was right. We're gonna. That's totally.
Is it right?
Totally. No, not
at all.
It's about a decade off.
Oh, you're all so young and beautiful. Unlike me, my getting old. The wrinkles are terrible. Anyway, no whining. Okay, so this is Memo R. Memory and piratey themed game. So Memo R was recommended for this year's Spiel des Jahres. Not nominated, so we can't win, but it was on the list. They do a nominations. Of course, there's always three games nominated. And then there's a recommended list, other games that they basically honorable mention. They thought that these are really great games, so they put it on that recommended list, which was really wonderful. And in Memo R, these cards are going to be on the table that have basically an animal on them. Be nice if I could not. Let's go backwards here. This is hard to do. So it has an animal, like this penguin, and a background. So all the cards are going to be face down on the table, and you're going to know a few cards in the beginning. Each player is going to know a few cards in the beginning, and you have to remember what those were as you match the cards that get turned over. So if a penguin got turned over, a penguin with a green background, you have to turn over either a penguin or the green background, the forest. And then you're... Then you've done that, and the next player goes. If you miss, you get a one of these volcano cards here, which means you're out of the round, and the last person that's still in the round will get a treasure card. After you've done this over five rounds, I think it's five rounds, when all the treasures are depleted, that's what it is. The game is over. The person with the most treasures is going to win. This is an amazing game for families. It's a nice filler game for gamers, but it's an amazing game for families. I've seen kids down to age 5 play it with the full set of rules. There's the two kinds of rules in the game, an advanced rule and a lighter rule. Kids down to age 5 play it and beat their parents because it's a memory game. And we're just not good at memory games. I mean, that's just it. My memories just go, especially when I play games. I like my beer with my games. So no memory. So really great family game. So you don't have to like throw games for kids and stuff like that. So that's Memo R.
Awesome.
How are we doing on time?
One
more after this,
I've never
right?
seen this game before.
Never saw this game before. Why would I?
This is brand new.
Why would I be showing the amazing Terraforming Mars? Because I'm showing the amazing Terraforming Mars because I want to just make sure everyone knows that we have got two expansions coming out this year, including one specifically at Gen Con. That's Prelude. In Terraforming Mars Prelude, it's a deck of cards that when you draft your corporations, you're going to be getting four Prelude cards, selecting two of those to keep with your one corporation. And that gives you more differentiation to your corporation versus the other ones. But the abilities on the Prelude cards are like these one-shot abilities that will basically jumpstart the economy of the game. So you might end up getting extra titanium that you're going to be able to use. My favorite is the eccentric sponsor card because some guy's picture kind of shows up on that card. I'm not sure who it is. Maybe people will be able to figure it out when they see the card.
I think I've got an idea.
You have an idea who that might be?
Yeah.
It's the cat.
It's the cat. Right. And that one says you can play a project card for 25 mega credits less. So on the first turn, you can bring in like the 45 mega credit project card. Yeah. You're jump-starting your economy of the game, and that's how that works. It's a $20 price point. We're going to have it at Gen Con, and it's actually going to go on pre-order on the Stronghold Games website, so it means we'll ship it to you before then, even. We're going to get that going within the next few days. So if you want it immediately, can pre-order from us, or if you're going to be at Gen Con, buy it at Gen Con. And finally, it'll be on the street on August 22nd, and that's 1995. And that is Prelude. This is, of course, the original.
Awesome.
This is the final, I think, right?
Yes, and we went over Paper Tales just
and we're
going to
be
bit.
Playing Paper Tales. And this is not even Paper Tales. This is the Paper Tales expansion. Ooh. So if you guys want to watch Paper Tales live in action next Thursday on Twist Gaming
PSI
Live.
Presents, 8 o'clock p.m. And you know, most of our PSI Presents and our Spotlight shows, we have our guests come to us via Skype. So they're usually in that little box right there up in Paper Tales. But we are going to have a very special in-person, live in-studio guest to play Paper
there.
Tales with
Since
us.
We're neighbors, since I could be there.
That's
so
fantastic.
I'm going to be with you guys, and that's next Thursday. And what time is it?
8 o'clock.
8 p.m.
8 p.m.? It's like almost like bedtime. No, I'm kidding. I'm not quite that old. But no, that's going to be great. But I'm just going to mention, so we won't go too much into Paper Tales, the card drafting game. You're building a fantasy civilization. That game comes out in a... an early launch kit for certain retailers on July 25th. So right before we play that game, right after we play the game, it's going to be there. Worldwide release is on August 8th. And then this is Paper Tales Beyond the Gate, where it takes the game from 1 to 7 players. The one-player game, you play against the Lich King in a special mode, and then it takes up to 7 players, all these new buildings in the game and all these new cards in the game, and this is going to release at the end of September. I believe it's the 25th or something like that of September.
Fantastic.
So, yeah, so this is a really big release for us. It's probably our biggest big box release for the season. And I think this is going to be great. People who love card drafting, a la like the Seven Wonders and the little building that you're doing in front of you, I think that's going to be a game. And I think we're going to have a great time playing that next week.
Josh and I had a chance to sit down and play it with one of our viewers who happens to be viewing us live right now. How you doing back there?
Hey.
That
guy.
Yeah, we got a chance to play it a little bit, so we're really excited to show it off on the
spotlight.
Oh,
awesome. Great. Awesome. I think that's it. My goodness.
That's it? No more? I'm really disappointed. I mean, there's only a few games.
We need to get other people in here.
Yes.
There you go.
All right. Well, thank you guys for having
Steven,
me.
Thank
it,
you so
yo,
much
I really appreciate
we
it.
We really love it.
You are the
thank
best,
you.
And I'm going to see you guys in like less than a week. Isn't that great?
It's really fun.
So cool. Yeah.
So thank all of you for watching at home as well. Stay tuned for some more coverage throughout the weekend here at Gen Con or Dice Tower Con. Oh, man. Dice Tower Con 2018. Signing off for now, though, I'm Matt.
I'm Ann.
I'm Stephen Bonacore.
Have a good one, everyone.
Bye. Bye.